The 911 attack on America looks so much like a formula action-packed Hollywood disaster movie that it had Made in the USA written all over it. The only difference is it used real props and real people. It had terrorist villains, American firefighter heroes, fireball explosions, collapsing buildings, pedestrians chased by dust clouds, and it even had a God Bless America music score. Well-positioned cameras shot the action-packed drama from every conceivable angle.
Just the picture of the helicopter landing and the president walking in. And then the
19 hijackers have been Saudi nationals. So in the terrible...
He said that he didn't believe that Osama bin Laden...
No one has blamed or accused him formally.
That how many people worked in the
city is confirming that some 265 firefighters are believed.
None of us will ever forget this day.
People who knocked these buildings down will hear all of it
soon. America remembers Sunday, 8th.
The timing, the title, and the eerie advertisement for Harvey Weinstein's Lord of the Rings movie called The Two Towers was a prophetic and disturbing coincidence. Profits from the Two Towers movie were small change compared to the 911 reality disaster movie, which has become the world's top grossing production of all time. The only thing missing are the 911 producer, writer, and director credits. But it doesn't take an Enron accountant to figure out who's cashing in. During the first week, the 911 producers made a spectacular fortune just on the stock market alone. How? By knowing in advance that the stocks in airline and insurance companies associated with the 911 crash would fall in value. Using that inside information, they made negative bets on the stock market called put options. Put options are bets that a certain stock will fall in value by a certain date. It's big risk gambling, unless you've got inside information that can turn your bet into a sure thing. But that's illegal if you get caught at it. Put option bets on the decline in 911 related airline and insurance stocks skyrocketed by a whopping 600% just before 911, which means that somebody knew about the attacks before they happened. Who exactly were those somebodies? Merrill Lynch and HSBC? Morgan Stanley Dean Witter? The Bank of America? Weapons manufacturer Raytheon? The Lehman Brothers? General Motors? Swiss Re, Munich Re, and AXA Re Insurance Company, which owns 25% of American Airlines. These insiders bought put options through Deutsche Bank.
Most demanding clients trust Deutsche Bank to perform. Deutsche Bank, a passion.
Buzzy Krongard, the former executive director of the CIA, just happened to be the manager of Deutsche Bank. And so the profiteers from 911 were not Osama bin Laden or his band of U.S.-trained Arabs. They were blue-chip Israeli, U.S., and British businessmen. Within the first week, the 911 producers sucked up $40 billion in box office profits from U.S. taxpayers who were hypnotized, terrorized, and traumatized by the infinite reruns.
Think of it as a conspiracy theory true or false test. A. When George W. Bush started his first oil company, who helped fund it? Osama bin Laden's brother and brother-in-law. True or false? B. After a terrorist bomb at a barracks in Saudi Arabia killed 19 Americans, who got the multi-million dollar contract to rebuild? The bin Ladens. True or false? C. On the morning of September 11th, 2001, who was in a meeting at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel in Washington? George Bush Sr. and Osama bin Laden's brother. True or false? Actually, the answer could be D, all of the above. Because believe it or not, as far-fetched as they sound, each and every one of those things, the bin Laden link to the Bush Oil Company, the bin Laden construction contract after the terrorist bomb, and the bin Laden-Bush meeting on 9/11, is true.
Many of the facts surrounding the events of 9/11 point to a cover-up. Like the fact that the Bush administration ignored all of the advance warnings of the 911 attacks. Warnings from FBI agents like Colleen Rowley and from the famous Phoenix memo were not only ignored, they were suppressed. FBI Deputy Director John P. O'Neill quit his job when his investigation of Osama bin Laden was blocked. According to a September 24th Newsweek article, top Pentagon officials canceled their travel plans for 911 because of security concerns. While the American public were sitting ducks, all of America's political, military, and corporate VIPs were kept out of harm's way. Two Muslims accused of the 911 hijackings took their flight training at Rudy Decker's Huffman Aviation School in Florida. Rudy Decker's is linked to the CIA and drug smuggling through Carib Air and Britannia Aviation, which shared the same small Venice airport with Decker's. The media reported that on the night before the attacks, accused ringleader Mohammed Atta and two other Muslim hijackers got drunk, fondled naked dancers in a Florida strip club called Shuckums, forgot their business card in their Quran holy book at the bar, publicly bashed America, and loudly boasted about impending bloodshed the next day. Would devoted and highly secretive Muslim hijackers risk their planned mission by attracting so much negative attention? And why were they in Florida instead of Boston the night before their suicide flights? On the early morning of September 11th, 19 Muslim men well known to intelligence and security agencies supposedly waltzed past airport security checks, boarded four passenger planes, and turned them into deadly missiles without even a hitch. By 8:13 a.m., flight controllers temporarily lost radar contact with American Airlines Flight 11 and reported a suspected hijacking. Even though Andrews Air Force Base is only 10 minutes from Washington, emergency response fighter jets took close to an hour instead of the typical 15 minutes to scramble and begin searching for the hijacked planes. By then, it was too late. President Bush already knew about the first Flight 11, which occurred at 8:46 a.m., when he sat down to chat with school kids at Booker Elementary School. It wasn't until 9:05 a.m. that he was notified that a second plane, Flight 175, had also crashed into the World Trade Center and that America was under attack. Instead of being whisked to safety in this national emergency, Bush nodded and continued chatting with the kids for another 20 minutes about a pet goat, while American citizens were burning alive and leaping to their death from the smoking towers.
Wailing against the wind as they fell, almost as if they had second thoughts. It was absolutely horrifying.
And you don't have to be a conspiracy theorist to wonder exactly what President George W. Bush knew about the attack, and when he knew it. According to the official White House version, it was at this moment in a Florida classroom that Bush learned the second plane had hit the World Trade Center and that the U.S. was under attack. But here's what George Bush himself said almost 3 months later when asked about September 11th.
I was sitting outside the classroom waiting to go in, and I saw an airplane hit the tower the TV was obviously on, and I used to fly myself, and I said, well, there's one terrible pilot. And I said, it must have been a horrible accident. But I was whisked off there. I didn't have much time to think about it.
Now, wait a minute. George Bush was told about the second plane while he was inside the classroom. So you just heard him describe seeing the first plane crash on television that day. But that's impossible. No one saw the first plane crash on TV on September the 11th because the videotape of it didn't surface until the next day.
At 9:55 a.m., President George W. Bush took off in Air Force One with no escort or protection from fighter jets and circled around for the next hour. Why was the president's plane airborne and unescorted for an entire hour while hijacked planes were roaming the skies? The inexperienced hijacker pilots who took only a simulated flying course reportedly flew the third hijacked plane, Flight 77, into a Top Gun 270-degree turn, bypassed the offices of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and crashed into an insignificant part of the Pentagon that was under renovation. Emergency response Air Force fighter jets were finally airborne when a fourth hijacked plane, Flight 93, crashed into a field in Pennsylvania at 10:06 a.m. The media reported that passengers overpowered the hijackers, but nearby residents saw U.S. fighter jets overhead and gave eyewitness reports of debris falling from the sky. That debris was found 8 miles away, indicating that the plane had been shot down. Within hours of the 911 hijackings, a massive Blame the Muslims campaign was launched by CNN and the media and continues to this day. In less than 48 hours, the names and mugshots of 19 accused Muslims were flashed across TV screens. If government investigators knew nothing, how did they identify 19 Muslim men as the hijackers so fast, from fake passports and with no DNA evidence? How could Muhammad Atta's passport survive the fireball explosion that supposedly cremated him, fly out of his pocket, fly out of the incinerated plane, flutter to the ground into 2 feet of debris, and end up in readable condition in the hands of investigators, all within 48 hours? Why did 19 Muslim men even need passports on domestic flights? How were passports found but not the plane's voice recorders? Why did the hijackers need passports they would never use again after their suicide flights? And why were the 19 accused Muslims not under surveillance on 911 if they were so easy to identify? The suitcase of accused ringleader Muhammad Atta was never loaded onto the hijacked plane and conveniently fell right into the hands of investigators. It was jam-packed with incriminating evidence, including a Quran, a how-to-fly-a-commercial-airplane video, and a fuel consumption indicator. Why would a hijacker about to die on a suicide mission pack a suitcase? It seems Muhammad Atta was a very forgetful ringleader who carried around a lot of Quran holy books. He reportedly forgot one Quran in a Florida strip club, another in a rental car, and still another one in his lost suitcase at the airport. More incriminating evidence of flight manuals written in Arabic were found within hours of the attacks in parked rental cars at the airports. Why didn't the terrorists take a taxi to the airport? Can they be that smart and that stupid at the same time? The conspicuous trail of planted evidence continued 3 weeks after the 911 attacks, when anthrax letters killed 5 people and were clearly worded to throw the blame on Muslims. Death to America, death to Israel, Allah is great. It has since been proven that the anthrax came from a U.S. Army lab and was never mailed by Muslims. Were the 19 Muslims accused of the hijacking set up as patsies and framed? If so, who set them up? Right after the attacks, CNN deceptively and repeatedly showed an airport security video of Muhammad Atta. CNN neglected to tell viewers that the video showed Muhammad Atta boarding a plane at Portland, Maine, not the hijacked plane. There are no airport security videos of any of the 19 accused Muslims boarding any of the hijacked planes. Right after the 911 attacks, CNN reported that the U.S. government had a tape recording of Osama bin Laden telling his mother that something big was about to happen and that she wouldn't be seeing him for a while. CNN later acknowledged that the report was false. Osama bin Laden consistently denied being involved in 911 and claimed the Israeli Zionists were behind the attacks. According to Japanese, Chinese, and Indian news reports, Osama bin Laden was killed in Afghanistan in the fall of 2001 and was buried in an unmarked grave by his own men.
Following the money trail, Osama bin Laden. Army sources telling me, even via Iraq, via other places overseas, we know where he is. We're on him. It's just a matter of time. Do you agree with that?
I believe he's dead.
Really?
I'm 98% positive that we killed him in December of 2001 during the Tour of War campaign. I've seen no proof of life since then, regardless of these tapes that are cobbled together.
On Halloween 2004, just before the U.S. presidential election, this man, dressed in an Osama bin Laden costume, confessed to the 911 attacks, scared American voters, and tricked them into treating George Bush to another 4 years in the White House. Zionist extremists believe that Hebrew Jews are God's chosen race of people with a God-given right to the land of Israel. The Muslim world and millions of Europeans, including Germany's former Minister of Technology, Andreas von Bülow, believe that Zionist extremists staged the 9/11 attacks on America to ignite the war on terrorism. That war has targeted Israel's Muslim enemies and is being fought and paid for with the blood, the lives, and the tax dollars of terrorized American citizens. The world believes that 9/11 was a conspiracy carried out by Islamic Muslim extremists with financing from Muslim charities. The other half believes it was a conspiracy carried out by Jewish Zionists with financing from Jewish charities. Is there any evidence to support that belief? Since 9/11, FBI Director Mueller, BBC News, and ABC have confirmed that 7 of the 19 Muslims whose mugshots were flashed around the world did not die in the 9/11 crashes. They are alive and well and are victims of identity theft. An 8th accused Muslim died 1 year before the 9/11 hijackings even occurred. Who stole their identities and why isn't the FBI looking for them? If the hijackers really were Muslims, why would they steal the identities of fellow Muslims and implicate them? Wouldn't they be more likely to steal Israeli identities and put the blame on Israelis? If the hijackers were Israelis, wouldn't they be likely to steal the identities of Muslims and put the blame on Muslims? Even though no one has been officially charged or convicted of the 9/11 hijackings, CNN and the 5 Western media monopolies have exclusively sold the American people on a Muslim conspiracy. Unfortunately, the only eyewitnesses capable of positively identifying the hijackers died on board the hijacked planes. Before flight attendant Amy Sweeney was killed on hijacked Flight 11, she picked up an airphone and reported that 4 Middle Eastern-looking men had hijacked the plane. The fact is that Israeli men are Middle Eastern men who just happen to be Middle Eastern-looking. The voice of the hijacker heard from the hijacked plane's voice recorder reveals that the accent of the hijacker matches an Israeli Hebrew accent.
The next transmission comes seconds later.
After 9/11, 1,000 Middle Eastern-looking Muslim men were swept into U.S. custody, but the media kept quiet about 60 Middle Eastern-looking Israeli men who were also taken into custody and held under great secrecy. On December 11th, Carl Cameron of Fox News ran the first of a four-part series about a group of Israelis who were among the 9/11 suspects. These detained Israelis failed polygraph tests about their surveillance activities against the U.S. and were caught videotaping the 9/11 attacks from different angles. Fox News also reported that the evidence linking these Israelis to 9/11 was classified, but a leaked 61-page report from the U.S. government's Drug Enforcement Agency revealed that another 120 Israelis posing as artists were also rounded up right after 9/11. Carrying counterfeit visas and green cards, the Israelis admitted that they served in the Israeli army in explosives, electronic, and military intelligence units. Did Middle Eastern-looking Israelis who were detained as suspects after 9/11 steal the identities of the accused Muslims? The leaked DEA report revealed that Israelis with Israeli military backgrounds had posed as artists and lived on Sheridan Street in Hollywood, Florida, just down the street from Muhammad Atta and 3 other accused Muslims. On August 18th, 1 month before the 9/11 attacks, a New York Times article by reporter Sheila K. Dewan described a group of 4 foreign artists who smuggled their way into the World Trade Center just months before 9/11. The artists occupied studio space free of charge on the 91st floor with 14 other artists and claimed to be writing a book called The Bee Thing. They also claim that they constructed a temporary balcony on the 91st floor as a prank. Somehow, these so-called artist pranksters escaped the attention of the World Trade Center's heavy security companies. George W. Bush's brother, Marvin Bush, just happened to be the director of Securicom, which provided electronic security for the World Trade Center. By some mysterious coincidence, Marvin Bush's company also provided electronic security for 911's United Airlines and 911's Dulles Airport. So what were 18 foreign artists really doing living free of charge in one of the world's most expensive rental spaces? Many top engineering and demolition experts believe that the twin towers were rigged with explosives which caused the buildings to implode vertically in a typical controlled demolition. The reason the collapsing buildings looked like a controlled demolition, say experts, is because they were a controlled demolition. Photos and video recordings confirm that explosions occurred at the base of the two towers as well as in Building 7 before they fell. On September 24th, firefighter Louis Caccioli told People Weekly point blank, "We think there were bombs set in the building." That claim was echoed by many witnesses and by firefighters who heard the explosions just before Tower 1, Tower 2, and Building 7 collapsed. The steel-supported twin towers were built to withstand the impact of a passenger jetliner, yet the official explanation for their collapse is that the burning jet fuel heated the steel support beams and caused them to buckle. Expert independent investigators insist that it's impossible for jet fuel burning in oxygen to melt steel and that most of the jet fuel burned up outside the buildings in clearly visible fireballs. After the crashes, the white smoke turned black, indicating cooling temperatures, not rising temperatures as reported. Why did a company called Controlled Demolition quickly haul away, melt down, and dispose of 499,850 pieces of structural steel that could have proved the temperature the steel had reached and the use of explosives? Why did Tower 2 that was hit last fall first, 53 minutes after being struck, whereas Tower 1 fell 1 hour and 28 minutes after being struck? An even bigger mystery is why Building 7, owned by Larry Silverstein, collapsed much later on in the afternoon, even though it had never even been hit. If these three World Trade Center buildings were rigged with explosives, when could the explosives have been installed, and who controlled access to the buildings? The 30-year-old World Trade Center has always been publicly owned and managed by the New York, New Jersey Port Authority. That is, until a Jewish businessman named Louis Eisenberg became the chairman. Eisenberg is an active leader in Jewish Zionist organizations. He personally oversaw negotiations that put the publicly owned World Trade Center into private hands. Those private hands belong to two Jewish pro-Zionist billionaires named Larry Silverstein and Frank Lowy, even though their bid was lower than other bids. Lowy served as a commando in the Israeli army, and Silverstein just happens to be the former chairman of the United Jewish Israel Appeal. With Eisenberg's help, they landed the 99-year lease worth $8 billion for half price at $3.5 billion. During the moving, renovations, and security changeovers, explosives could have easily been installed in the buildings without detection. George W.'s brother, Marvin Bush, was not only the director of the World Trade Center's electronic security company, he was also the director of the World Trade Center's casualty insurance company called Houston Casualty. That company terminated their insurance coverage for the World Trade Center before 911, right in the nick of time. Another suspicious company occupied the 16th and 17th floors of the North Tower. That company, called Zim Israeli American Shipping, suddenly broke their lease, paid a $50,000 penalty, and moved out of the World Trade Center only weeks before 911. Zim Israeli American Shipping is owned by Zim Israel Navigation, which just happens to be owned by the government of Israel. If the new owners, Silverstein and Lowy, knew about the 911 attacks in advance, why did they buy a 99-year lease to the doomed buildings? Because they could do the simple math. Silverstein bought the $3.5 billion World Trade Center with only a $15 million down payment, which amounts to 0.01% of the total. He took out maximum terrorist insurance coverage only 6 weeks before the attacks. The demolition of the World Trade Center buildings on 9/11 eliminated Silverstein's cost for an $800 million facelift to update the aging 30-year-old buildings. As soon as the spanking new World Trade Center is finally built and expanded to over 11 million square feet of rental space, Silverstein stands to pocket billions of dollars per month. In the meantime, U.S. taxpayers are covering Silverstein's so-called losses. Then there's the big payouts from insurance policies with mega-terrorism insurance, which Silverstein took out just weeks before 9/11. Silverstein is demanding a 200% payout by claiming payouts for two separate 9/11 attacks instead of one. Silverstein's insurance companies, called Swiss Re and Munich Re, are the same companies under investigation for advanced knowledge of 9/11 and for profiting from 9/11 on the stock market. If Silverstein's insurance companies knew in advance about the attacks, why would they insure doomed buildings? Were these giant insurance companies handpicked to keep a lid on their insurance investigation findings and to ignore the evidence of 9/11 cover-ups? Silverstein has since bought out Frank Lowy, paid off investors and loan groups, put limits on victim compensation claims, and turned the publicly owned World Trade Center into the smelliest private real estate deal in American history. George W. Bush threw up permanent roadblocks to stop an independent investigation of the 9/11 events. When the 9/11 Senate Committee report was published, 27 pages that would have connected international banks to 9/11 were censored. On October 30, 2003, a CBC television documentary investigated the 10-year friendship between the Bush family, the Bin Laden family of Saudi Arabia, and the Saudi royal family. That friendship includes illegal presidential campaign contributions and partnerships in oil and weapons companies like the Carlyle Group. Since 9/11, 2,500 relatives of victims filed trillion-dollar lawsuits against seven international banks, against the Saudi friends of the Bush family, and against the U.S. government for suppression of information. On 9/11, all U.S. flights were canceled, and desperate relatives of 9/11 victims were grounded.
48 hours later, September 13th, an update. Private flights were still prohibited. To take off required government approval at the highest level. That morning, Prince Bandar of Saudi Arabia visited the White House. And later that day, something unusual began to happen. Despite the blanket aviation ban, several private planes, from Learjets to a 747, were cleared to depart from various U.S. cities. On board were dozens of the Saudi elite, almost every one a Bin Laden or a Saudi royal. Meanwhile, Elizabeth Alderman was desperate to find a way from Paris to New York, where her son Peter was missing.
The Bin Laden family, whoever was in the United States, got safe passage home, and I couldn't get home to be with my children. Other families couldn't get to New York, who lived far away, to even begin to look for their children. At this point, we didn't know who was alive or who was dead. I couldn't get home, and the Bin Laden family were all able to get home.
Since 15 of the 19 hijackers were accused of being Muslims from Saudi Arabia, why wasn't the fury of George W. Bush directed at Saudi Arabia instead of opium-rich Afghanistan and oil-rich Iraq? Before the first plane ever even hit the first tower on 9/11, a massive military buildup was organized near Afghanistan called Operation Swift Sword and Operation Bright Star. 23,000 British troops were sent to the Oman Gulf near Afghanistan, and 17,000 U.S. troops joined NATO troops in nearby Egypt. All of these forces were positioned for attacks on the Muslim countries of Afghanistan and Iraq before 9/11. The Patriot Act, which was designed to limit American citizens' democratic rights and freedoms, was also designed and written months before the first plane ever even hit the first tower. So who exactly are the producers of the 9-1-1 reality disaster movie that collected billions from insider stock market trades, $200 billion and counting from terrorized U.S. taxpayers, and gazillions of dollars from the conquest of Iraq's oil fields and Afghanistan's opium fields? Contrary to popular opinion, the producers of 9-1-1 are not practicing Jews. And contrary to popular opinion, the producers of 9-1-1 are not practicing Muslims.
Hello.
They are a secret network of international pirates who identify with no nation, no national flag, and no established religion. Their flag is the skull and crossbones, and their god, G-O-D, spells gold, oil, and drugs.
It is important to understand the difference between the term Jews, Hebrews, and Zionists. The majority of the world's Jewish population are honest, caring, honorable people who practice Judaism, follow religious tradition, and embrace good moral values. The term Hebrew refers to the Hebrew language. It also refers to the Hebrew people, who are the ethnic descendants of the original 12 tribes of Israel. The term Zionist refers to political extremists. Zionists believe that the Hebrews are God's chosen race of people and that the Hebrews have a right to the land of the Muslim Palestinians. Why? Because according to the Bible, God said so. These Zionist extremists represent only a small minority of Jews and Hebrews. Christians who support Israel's theft of Palestinian land are called Christian Zionist extremists. Their goal is to help fulfill the prophecies of the Bible story.
Countless millions of Americans are reading a series of novels called Left Behind. They're topping bestseller lists all over the country, and they're being made into movies. They chronicle apocalyptic times. The setting is the 21st century, complete with warplanes and TV correspondence.
This is Buck Williams reporting live from Israel. I am standing in the middle of an all-out attack.
But the plot is ripped from the pages of the Bible, so it all winds up here in Israel, where, according to the book of Revelations, the final battle in the history of the future will be fought on this ancient battleground in northern Israel called Armageddon. It will follow 7 years of tribulation, during which the earth will be shaken by such disasters that previous human history will seem like a day in the country.
Ago, the United States dropped the atomic bomb on Japan. To this day, Americans know very little about how that decision was reached.
The idea that the United States committed these and other horrific crimes against humanity and participated in the 9-1-1 incineration of thousands of its own citizens is too frightening a thought for many to consider. But even more frightening are the consequences of denial. Did the world wars, revolutions, and big events of human history evolve naturally, or were they calculated and pre-planned? If they were pre-planned, who planned them, and what are they planning for the future of humanity? The answer to this puzzling question can be found within the boundaries of three of the world's most powerful cities. Those three cities belong to no nation and pay no taxes. They are Washington's District of Columbia, which is not part of the city of Washington or of the United States, the inner city of London, which is not part of London or England, and Vatican City, which is not part of Rome or Italy. These cities, called city-states, have their own independent flag their own separate laws, and their own separate identity.
Vatican City is in fact a state, the smallest principality in the world. It lies on the banks of the Tiber, completely surrounded by the city of Rome. Its status as a separate state emerged from the Lateran agreements of February 1929. It has its own newspaper, postal service, radio and television station, its own flag, and a population of about 1,000.
The Vatican also has its own army of Swiss guards, and it even has its own prison. Gracing the walls of St. Peter's Basilica is the Vatican-approved image of God, an angry, bearded man in the sky, painted by Michelangelo. Sinners who disobey God's list of thou shalt nots risk incurring his wrath and damnation and burning in Satan's eternal hellfire. Cruel and violent images of God's tortured son suffering, bleeding, and dying, with thorns gouged through his skull and nails pounded through his feet and hands, are on display throughout the Vatican. These images serve as reminders that God allowed his son to be tortured and killed to save the souls of human beings who are all born sinners. These explanations and scary images are especially difficult for children to comprehend. The Vatican rules over approximately 2 billion of the world's 6.1 billion people. The colossal wealth of the Vatican includes enormous investments with the Rothschilds in Britain, France, and the USA, and with giant oil and weapons corporations like Shell and General Electric. The Vatican's solid gold bullion worth billions is stored with the Rothschild-controlled Bank of England and the US Federal Reserve Bank. The Catholic Church is the biggest financial power, wealth accumulator, and property owner in existence, possessing more material wealth than any bank, corporation, giant trust, or government anywhere on the globe. The Pope, who is the visible ruler of this colossal global wealth, is one of the richest men on earth. While two-thirds of the world earns less than $2 a day, and one-fifth of the world is underfed or starving to death, the Vatican hoards the world's wealth, profits from it on the stock market, and at the same time preaches about giving. How did the Pope and Vatican accumulate all that wealth over the millennium? One method was to put a price tag on sin. Many bishops and popes actively marketed guilt, sin, and fear for profit by selling indulgences. Worshippers were encouraged to prepay for sins they hadn't yet committed and get pardoned ahead of time. Those who didn't pay up risked eternal damnation in Satan's oven. Pope Leo X rebuilt St. Peter's Basilica, selling tickets out of hell and tickets to heaven. During the Dark Ages, the Catholic Church not only hoarded the wealth they collected from the poor, but hoarded knowledge. They kept the masses ignorant and in the dark by denying them a basic education.
More than 60,000 armed Christians were on their way to reclaim Jerusalem from the infidel.
Between 1095 and 1291 AD, the Pope launched seven bloodbaths called the Christian Crusades, torturing, burning, beheading, and mass murdering hundreds of thousands of Muslims and Jews in the name of God. The Pope's brutal soldiers were called Knights Templar, or Knights of the Temple of Solomon, and evolved into today's secretive brotherhood called the Freemasons. Between 1450 and 1700 AD, the Catholic Church followed up their holy terror with the Inquisition. Based on rumors of practicing witchcraft, the Catholic Church hunted down, tortured, and burned alive millions of innocent women at the stake.
Executioner, do your duty!
World War II, the Vatican was criticized for supporting Hitler and his Nazi regime. To this day, the Vatican is still under investigation for plundering Nazi gold from the Swiss bank accounts of Jewish Holocaust victims. Over the past five decades, more than 1,500 priests and bishops have been identified in the sexual assault of tens of thousands of boys and girls in their trusting congregations and orphanages. Why is this filthy rich institution preaching spiritual values of poverty and chastity while cardinals, bishops, and priests cover up their crimes of sexual abuse? Why has the church fought and resisted the compensation claims of their sexually, emotionally, and spiritually traumatized victims? Like Vatican City, London's inner city is also a privately owned corporation or city-state, located right smack in the heart of Greater London. It became a sovereign state in 1694 when King William III of Orange privatized and turned the Bank of England over to the bankers. By 1812, Nathan Rothschild crashed the English stock market and scammed control of the Bank of England. Today, the city-state of London is the world's financial power center and the wealthiest square mile on the face of the earth. It houses the Rothschild-controlled Bank of England, Lloyd's of London, the London Stock Exchange, all British banks, the branch offices of 385 foreign banks, and 70 U.S. banks. It has its own courts, its own laws, its own flag, and its own police force. It's not part of Greater London or England or the British Commonwealth and pays no taxes. The city-state of London houses Fleet Street's newspaper and publishing monopolies. It is also the headquarters for worldwide English Freemasonry and headquarters for the worldwide money cartel known as the Crown. Contrary to popular belief, the Crown is not the royal family or the British monarch. The Crown is the private corporate city-state of London. It has a council of 12 members who rule the corporation under a mayor called the Lord Mayor. The Lord Mayor and his 12-member council serve as proxies or representatives who sit in for 13 of the world's wealthiest, most powerful banking families. This ring of 13 ruling families includes the Rothschild family, the Warburg family, the Oppenheimer family, and the Schiff family. These families and their descendants run the Crown Corporation of London. The Crown Corporation holds the title to worldwide Crown land in Crown colonies like Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. The British Parliament and the British Prime Minister serve as a public front for the hidden power of these ruling Crown families. Like the city-state of London and the Vatican, a third city-state was officially created in 1982. That city-state is called the District of Columbia and is located on 10 square miles of land in the heart of Washington. The District of Columbia flies its own flag and has its own independent constitution. Although geographically separate, the city-states of London, the Vatican, and the District of Columbia are one interlocking empire called Empire of the City. The flag of Washington's District of Columbia has three red stars, one for each city-state in the three-city empire. This corporate empire of three city-states controls the world economically through London's inner city, militarily through the District of Columbia, and spiritually through the Vatican. The constitution for the District of Columbia operates under a tyrannical Roman law known as Lex Fori, which bears no resemblance to the U.S. Constitution. When Congress passed the Act of 1871, it created a separate corporate government for the District of Columbia. This treasonous act allowed the District of Columbia to operate as a corporation outside the original Constitution of the United States and outside of the best interests of American citizens. A sobering study of the signed treaties and charters between Britain and the United States exposes a shocking truth. The United States has always been, and still is, a British Crown colony. King James I was famous not for just changing the Bible into the King James Version, but for signing the First Charter of Virginia in 1606. That charter granted America's British forefathers a license to settle and colonize America. The charter also guaranteed that future kings and queens of England would have sovereign authority over all the citizens and colonized land in America stolen from the Indians. After America declared its independence from Great Britain, the Treaty of 1783 was signed. That treaty specifically identifies the King of England as the Prince of the United States and contradicts the belief that America won the War of Independence. Although King George III of England gave up most of his claims over his American colonies, he kept his right to continue receiving payment for his business venture of colonizing America. If America had really won the War of Independence, they would never have agreed to pay debts and reparations to the King of England. When Congress passed the 13th Amendment to the Constitution, the U.S. President was made subservient to the King of England. The 13th Amendment is called the Title of Nobility Amendment and forbids U.S. presidents and their officials from using royal titles like King or Prince or Baron. For some mysterious reason, the 13th Amendment, which was ratified in 1810, no longer appears on current copies of the Constitution. America's blood-soaked War of Independence against the British bankrupted America and turned its citizens into permanent debt slaves of the King. In the War of 1812, the British torched and burned to the ground the White House and all U.S. government buildings and destroyed ratification records of the U.S. Constitution. One century later, a corrupt U.S. Congress committed the biggest theft in world history. They passed Paul Warburg's Federal Reserve Act in 1913, handing over America's gold and silver reserves and total control of America's economy to the Rothschild banksters. Most Americans still believe that the Fed or Federal Reserve is the government. It is not. The Fed is a privately owned banking system whose majority Class A shareholders are the Rothschilds, Warburgs, Kuhn and Loeb, J.P. Morgan, Rockefeller, Israel Seif, and the Lehman Brothers. This private banking cartel is the Fed and is never audited and never pays taxes. They print and design America's money, which displays their symbols of an Egyptian pyramid, a Masonic all-seeing eye, and the words "In God We Trust." Who exactly is the God they trust? They also collect American taxpayers' money through the IRS. Then they loan it back again with interest to pay for roads, bridges, and other public works. American presidents are hand-picked and financed by these special interest power groups. Like George W. Bush, John Forbes Kerry, whose initials are JFK, is a member of Yale University's Skull and Bones Brotherhood. The Forbes part of John Kerry's name identifies his descendancy from Captain Robert Bennett Forbes, who was a drug runner for the Rothschilds' opium drug trade with China in the 1800s. Most U.S. citizens believe that the United States is a country and that the president is the most powerful man on earth. The United States is not a country. It is a corporation, and the president is president of the corporation of the United States. He and his elected officials work for the corporation, not for the American people. Since the United States is a corporation, who owns the corporation of the United States? Like Canada and Australia, whose leaders are prime ministers of the Queen and whose land is called Crown Land, the United States is just another Crown Colony. Crown colonies are controlled by the empire of three city-states. At the center of each city-state is a towering, phallic-shaped stone monument called an obelisk that points skyward. In D.C. city-state, the obelisk, known as the Washington Monument, was dedicated to Freemason George Washington by the Freemason Grand Lodge of the District of Columbia. The secretive Brotherhood of Freemasons laid the Washington obelisk's cornerstone in 1848 and contributed 22 Masonic memorial stones. 250 Masonic lodges financed the Washington Monument obelisk, including the Knights Templar Masonic Order. At the heart of London city-state is a 187-ton, 69-foot-tall Egyptian obelisk called Cleopatra's Needle. It was transported from Egypt and erected on the banks of the River Thames. In Vatican City, Another Egyptian obelisk towers high above St. Peter's Square. What exactly is an obelisk? Obelisks are phallic-shaped monuments honoring the pagan sun god of ancient Egypt called Amun-Ra. The spirit of this pagan god is said to reside within the obelisk. Obelisks symbolize the phallus and fertility. At the base of the obelisk is a sun wheel circle symbolizing the vagina. Together, they depict male and female sexual union. Worshippers of Amun believe Amun is the supreme god and creator of all things and can transform himself into other gods like Osiris, the god of the underworld, or Seth, the god of evil and chaos. Since vowels were interchangeable in the biblical Hebrew language, Amun can be spelled A-M-E-N, A-M-O-N, O-M-O-N, or A-M-U-N. Today, Amun is one of the most popularly used words in the entire world. It is used in all languages by Christians, Muslims, Hindus, and Jews at the end of prayer. Without realizing it, people all over the world are praising Amun. The Old Testament of the Bible is the holy book of both Christians and Jews. Amun is repeated over and over again throughout the Bible and is hidden within the word testament. The word Amun literally means the hidden one. Many are fooled into believing that Amun means so be it or truly, but in Kings 1 verse 36 of the Old Testament, Amun is identified as the Lord God of my Lord. Why in the world would the Vatican, a fortress of Puritan Christian values, erect a monument symbolizing the pagan god Amun and sexual intercourse right in its own front yard? Bloodshed between the Israeli Jews and the Palestinian Muslims is routinely reported by the Western news media. But how much does the general public really know about what's going on in Israel? And why should they even care? Why? Because Israel has written human history, and it is also writing the future of humanity. It is important to know that the land now called Israel was originally called Canaan in ancient times. Canaan was populated by the Canaanite people, who were the ancestors of today's Palestinians imprisoned in refugee camps in Israel. About 3,500 years ago, the Semitic Hyksos kings ruled Egypt for 100 years, but were expelled from Egypt into Canaan. The Egyptians called these Hyksos people the Habarus, which means Hebrews. These expelled Hebrews invaded and conquered the land of Canaan and changed the name of the land from Canaan to Israel. AD, the name was once again changed to Palestine after the Romans conquered the land. As recently as 1948, the name was officially changed back to Israel again by the Hebrew Zionists, who slaughtered and drove the Palestinian people from their homes, land, and villages after World War II. Understand what's really going on in the world today is to journey back in time and dig up the ancient secrets of the past. Those ancient secrets have been hidden by the ruling class beneath the shifting sands of Egypt for more than 4,000 years.